Hello everyone, my name is Nathan, and today it's time for the second part of our Factorio playthrough from Zero to Megabase. In between the episodes, I made sure to plan out everything that is necessary in order to start with the Megabase today. I'm not sure if you recognize it from the previous episode, which I highly recommend you to watch if you haven't yet, but this is our main bus. I basically took everything apart that was our factory right here. I only kept the oil stuff in, and I exchanged the factories on the top here with circuit factories, as you can see here. I even beaconed them up because I needed a lot of circuits in order to build this module factory, which is making one module per minute exactly. The ratio is also pretty good. If we check this out, you can see the ratios are pretty much perfectly balanced. Per module, we have two machines creating level 1, with one assembler having 4 speed modules and one assembler only having 2. Then we have one assembler for the level 2 module with 3 speed modules inside and one assembler for the level 3 speed module with nothing inside. And therefore we're getting one module per minute. If I want to bump this up, I will have to radically increase the amount of circuits I'm getting in at the moment. Yeah, the problem are the red circuits. I would only have to expand this a little bit. I think we still have enough intake here. But yeah, at the rate this is crafting, I'm actually pretty happy. I think we're gonna leave this be for now. What I actually want to show you now is the beginning of our mega base, and I should probably do that on the map first. You can see it right here. It already looks like quite much, but it really isn't. All of these areas marked with a solar panel are simply solar panels. So these are our power generators. Everywhere in between, I'm going to have my rail lines. I want to avoid four-way intersections if possible, so we're just gonna go with three-way like this. And right here in the center, I'm gonna go away from the usual shape I'm gonna have throughout the map. But this is a special area. Right here, I'm delivering materials for my personal use. Actually, let me take the Spidertron and go right here. So here we have the arrival of raw materials. Here we have the processing of raw materials such as oil, plastics, and then we also smelt all the iron and steel, etc. And then right here on the top, I have everything that is necessary for base building. This intersection here I just set up in order to get access to the personal materials. You can see here tiny trains coming in with raw iron, copper, coal and stone. This is then all being transported up here, being processed inside of these. We're gonna build one of these arrangements, don't worry. And then on the left side here, as I said, we're gonna create all the liquids and plastics that we're needing, the explosives. Everything is being transported up into these passive provider chests. You can see them all over the place right here. And of course, right here, I'm crafting everything necessary in order to do base building. We still have the space to add more stuff, obviously. I divided the items up between me and the Spidertron, which is also gathering up a bunch of items I do not want to clog up in my inventory. Let's say I want to keep this system here as power efficient as possible, so I'm just gonna fill all of these up with efficiency modules. They don't need to be particularly fast, and I have plenty of modules available. With this all out of the way, we basically established the first step into a mega base. Now it's all about planning and where we want to set things up, how we do it. Basically, I decided to smelt up copper right here and smelt up iron right here as a first step. So we need trains coming in from here, delivering the ore. Then we're gonna smelt it up, and at the top we're gonna have a train station to bring them somewhere else. For the base crafting system, I essentially tapped into various sources here. You can see this doesn't really have a system, it's just basically functional and it delivers what I need to get this started. The copper to begin with, I think I'm just gonna bring in from here. Actually, this might not be large enough. Yeah, what we want to achieve is an intake of 4 blue belts and smelt it all up. That means we're probably gonna need at least 2 trains and therefore also 2 sources of copper, which means I'm gonna need to do either pre-planning or just establish the rails early enough. My guess here as a first step, what we want to do is make a design for the rail and actually blueprint it. Now it would be great to have a setup such as this, so we basically have 4 rails next to each other, 2 in either direction. And then whenever a train needs to go to a train station, it's gonna choose the outer rail. And if it doesn't need to go to that train station, it's gonna choose the inner rail. And hopefully once the system grows, we're gonna be very grateful. My current blueprints contain the bot network, including a path all the way around, of course the already completed solar panel array, and then I also have a simple underground if I desire to set this up. But yeah, I guess now it's all about designing all the possible scenarios with the rails. We're gonna have areas where the rails are just gonna go straight, sometimes it's gonna be a T-intersection. Sometimes there's gonna be an unloading station on the top, and sometimes there's gonna be a loading station at the bottom, and sometimes there's even gonna be both. As a general rule of thumb, I'm always gonna deliver items at the bottom, process them, and then ship them out at the top. Alright, so some modules are more straightforward than others if we just have the straight rails, of course. The empty spaces in each module I'm gonna try to fill out with more solar panels and capacitors. However, now we come to the T-intersections. Now I decided that on these intersections the trains are gonna have the capability of switching the lane they are currently on as well as the direction. This is why it looks a little bit complicated, but essentially if a train is coming from here, it has the possibility to just go straight, or it can go into this direction, or it can also switch the rail into this direction. Now the only directions I haven't covered is a switch from this rail to this rail and vice versa, so they will not be able to change the lane in the same direction. But theoretically, by the time they arrive at such an intersection, they should already be on the right rail. Now the signaling in this game is unnecessarily complicated, but essentially you have two types of signals, the rail signal and the rail chain signal. Before each intersection you want to set up a chain signal, and once the intersection is over you want a normal rail signal. As a second rule of thumb, whenever you have the space for an entire train you want to set up a rail signal, and every other time you want to do a chain signal. That means we're gonna need way more chain signals, but let's get started with one direction. We're gonna take this direction, get started with this rail. So we arrive at the intersection, we wanna set up a chain signal. Then we're gonna cover the straight direction first. We wanna set up another chain signal here. Right here we don't have the space for it, but before every intersection, wherever we have the space, we wanna set up a chain signal. And then here at the very end, where we have the space for an entire train, we're gonna do the rail signal, right there. Now let's cover the next direction. There is another intersection here, and we don't have the space for that, so we're just gonna take it as one. And at the end, we have the space for an entire train right there and there. We then cover the next rail, chain signal here. If we go straight, we want more chain signals, like so. Now, this could be potentially a problem if we want to set up more signals. So we can decide to put fewer chain signals. But for now, we're just gonna keep going. There's gonna be another one here, and then we have the space for the rail signal. So coming from here, chain, chain, and then a rail signal there. Chain, chain, there is no space here, but we have space there. Chain, chain, and normal signal. Chain, chain, and normal. And then we have the last direction from the top. Chain, chain, normal. We can also go down. There is the space for a chain signal. Here we already have one. Chain, we already got one here. If we go down, we can set up one there. And that is probably all we can do. The way we set this up right now, whenever there is a train in the blue area, the other trains are going to wait. I'm gonna take myself the liberty of redesigning this intersection. If it is too complicated, it could be a little bit aggravating if we have more trains. Thankfully, due to blueprints, it's gonna be easy to swap this out. Once we can make a blueprint out of this, we also have the capability of turning it in each direction. And then last but not least, I'm gonna show you an example of an unloading station. I'm gonna make something similar with a loading station. So all we have to do is make the outside train go into the station, whether it's coming from this direction or the other one, and then it will be unloaded. It then has the possibility to go out in each direction. Actually, the going out part we can make a little bit better, so they have the possibility to take either route. We probably want to do the same thing here. We want to give them access to both rails when going out already. Maybe it would make more sense to give the unloading station access from this rail. So if we do this instead, we're gonna have fewer trains crossing each other. Let me just go ahead and also signal these guys up. By the way, you can charge if you have too many signals. If you place a signal and nothing changes, you can probably leave that out. But yeah, we have so many rails and intersections here, it's not possible to place a signal before each and every single one. Okay, I'm guessing this is good enough. We'll have to see it in action. Now I'm also gonna build a loading station. Yeah, this is the unloading station and then a loading station for the ore or end products. Then I'm gonna put everything into a blueprint and after that we can kind of go mayhem. Obviously, this is just, you know, building space at the moment. The first thing we're gonna do, take copper, bring it over here. Take iron, bring it over here. And then hopefully we can also come up with nifty designs to actually get 4 full belts. Considering a good portion in my intersection here is blue, that means trains will have to wait for each other anyways. So that might be another thing we want to change. But I'm guessing, yeah, there are a couple of signals we can get rid of now, just to clean it up a bit. Nice, looking much better already. Everything is green now, as it should be. If we go ahead and place a train here, then all the signals from the incoming lines are going red. Except, of course, if they want to go straight, they can do that. But if they want to go left, they will have to wait. I have another good example of a light that might not seem necessary, but actually is. You can see something changes here. So if I don't have the light here when a train actually goes across this intersection, then the train here at the bottom wanting to go straight also has to wait. However, with the chain signal right here, it will not have to wait, because that is now another color and not influenced by the blue. Alrighty, we're back. I had to rearrange a couple of modules in order to decide how I want to do it. The more we build, the clearer it will become. But essentially, I hooked up this iron mine and now we are coming all the way down here to this spot where we're gonna cook things up. And this is the unloading station where we are at the moment. So my train is gonna come over to this station called Unload Iron Ore. If we then go ahead and actually follow the tracks, we should see some of the intersections here. Wherever I have an intersection, on the top I will have a solar panel array. And then all the other stations can also be solar panel arrays, but they also have the opportunity to be something else. So I can set up an unloading and loading station here and I can utilize them as such. So in this case, that would mean right here we are setting up a solar panel array and then here we can have a production. Well, let's just go ahead and keep following the rails. Actually, we're just gonna go to the destination. And here we are. I just decided to make a makeshift solution for the time being. I didn't want to hook it up completely just yet. This is gonna be the loading station. Here we have the train station named Load Iron Ore. Okay, with that out of the way, I would say we're gonna set up a locomotive right there. We're also gonna need 4 wagons, just like that. We're gonna give the locomotive some initial fuel, but we're gonna take care of automatic refueling in a second. We are then going to add a station, Load Iron Ore. We want to wait for a full cargo. Add another station, Unload Iron Ore, and we want to wait for an empty cargo. We're then gonna set this to automatic, and that should theoretically already work. Yeah, it's now waiting. As soon as we get multiple trains for the same task, we're gonna have to do it slightly differently, but more to that later. For now, I just wanna see this filled up, and look at that, it goes rather quickly. And of course, all the miners are working for me. They cannot quite manage to fill up 4 entire belts, but we're probably gonna have enough for the beginning. And there we go, we're almost full. The train goes, let's actually follow it. Let's check this out. Some lights turned red. Okay, yeah. So 2 trains cannot really go through. Oh, why is this still? Ah, okay. It actually works. But yeah, my intersection solution is probably not the best one. But here we are at the unloading station. And you can see we should be able to actually fill up 4 entire blue belts using this method. But we will see. Anyways, what we now want to do is generate a smelting setup that is going to be capable of taking care of 1 entire blue belt. In order to do that, we're going to do some brainstorming. Maybe let's get started with an electric furnace. We're going to set that up here. And then we want to have a beacon that is just barely touching it. Something like that. We can then have up to 8 beacons affecting the same furnace. So that would be 4 and possibly another 4 like so. We then want to continue with a furnace pattern such as this. We are then gonna take our express underground belt. So this is where the input is gonna be coming from. And we wanna do something like that. Come out here, go there, go here, and just keep moving through the contraption like this. We're then gonna use stack inserters just to be sure in order to get those materials into the furnaces. First of all, the furnaces on the right side, but then also the furnaces on the left side. And we can probably choose either output here. Maybe if we think about the power, it's gonna be more clear where we have to set this up. Let's say we add power poles in front of each furnace. This way we should be able to power all contraptions. Then we're gonna input the iron ore to the left furnaces like so. There's gonna be another one and probably another one here. Well, let's continue. We now have the input. In order to get the materials out of there, we're gonna do something like that for the right furnaces. So they're gonna go on a conveyor belt here. And then for the furnaces on the left side, we wanna do that. Now, I will explain more to that in just a bit. Let's just finish that. We then get the blue output belt. So it's gonna be put here on the left side of the belt. And if we do something like that, this guy here is gonna put it on the right side of the belt because they always put it on the right side in the direction of the belt. And now we can just continue like so. And here we should have the output. Now let's continue the beacons. We wanna make sure we set up as many as possible. Yeah, this one is still barely touching the furnace. That's good. We're gonna fill up all the beacons with speed modules, just like that. And then we're gonna fill up all the furnaces with productivity modules, 4 of them. It's gonna make them much slower and consume more energy, but we're compensating that with the beacons. So let's take the center here in order to import the materials. And then on the other side, it's gonna come out and we get the finished product. Did I forget anything? I'm not so sure. Let's just go ahead and build the underground here first. I want this all tiled up. So now all my robots should take care of that. And then I'm gonna blueprint this out. We're gonna build 4 of these contraptions, 1 for each belt. And I kind of want to make sure I space them out correctly. The cool thing about this design is you can take it and tile it without using many more beacons. And by the way, of course, I learned about this design by Nilaus. Ah, look at all my robots working. This is just great. I can set up the blueprints and in the background, they are finishing them. So let's actually go ahead and we're gonna blueprint this. This is gonna be the ore smelter, taking quite a few materials, but then again, it's mainly the modules that are a problem. Let's create this blueprint. And now all I have to do is cut this out. I believe I can do that and just get rid of it. And now we have to find the perfect center in order to set up 4 of these production lines. Also, I totally forgot to fuel my train. I kind of wanted to do this here. Do we have a requester chest? I want to put this somewhere here probably. And we are gonna request at least, let's say, 4 stacks of coal. Actually, let me put this one block over so it is still being powered. And there, I believe, you know, just one normal inserter is gonna do the trick for this. Gonna give this guy some extra fuel. Should be enough to make it back to the station. And there we go. We already have some coal in the chest and you can see it is being filled up now. Wow, just check out how quickly this cargo is emptying. This is insane. Stack inserters are great. And there it goes again. Wonderful. Okay, now let me just go ahead and finish the smelter design for both the iron as well as the copper, which is gonna be on the other side here. And then we'll be right back. Alrighty, here we are back with the finished smelter design. I had to expand it by a couple of furnaces. There are 13 furnaces now. And if we go ahead, check this out, this should be exactly one blue belt of output. Actually, I need to connect this first. It doesn't know what to smelt. So we are gonna hook this up just like that. We have our balancer right there and we should be getting a full belt worth of iron ore in there and smelt it up immediately. Very nice. We can see the first pieces come out here at the very end. And now that all furnaces had something to do, I should be able to check this out again. And we can see it is exactly 45 items per second. A little bit more, but that is fine. That's gonna ensure that we can have an entire belt. Now, once again, there are 13 furnaces per belt, which means they are not even. And so at the very last furnace, I had to add 2 inserters to get the items out of there. One inserter right here is putting them on the left side of the belt, and this inserter is putting them on the right side of the belt. And this is gonna ensure we always have a full belt. And now all we have to do is set up a loading station right here for the trains in order to pick up the iron plates. Oh no, looks like I haven't designed the loading station just yet. Let's do that here. We're just gonna use that square temporarily. First thing I want to do is set up an underground for this. Then we're gonna go with a straight rail. So this one is gonna go right there. Now I wonder, could we just go ahead and maybe flip this around like so? Save us a little bit on work. Yeah, looks like it works out. There are just a couple of poles misplaced, but that is fine. And now we are gonna turn this around. Basically, I would like to see the same system here, but we are going to turn everything around concerning the belts. I just wanted it laid out so I know exactly where to place it. Actually, maybe I can go ahead and just copy this over. I've already built this loading station. The question is, do I want to face it this way or flip it? Yeah, I think this makes more sense. So let's place this right there. Yes, that's what I'm talking about. Now all we have to do is set up a balancer right here. Come on, I should blueprint this. And now we just bring these around into the inputs there. And one more like so. Wonderful. I kind of like it. Okay, I would say we're just gonna go ahead and try it. If I copy over this portion, we should be able to place it. So we're smelting up the iron here, and all we have to do is place this station, and then we should be golden, ready to pick things up. Cool, now I just have to wait for this to be built. In the meantime, we can hook these guys up, like so, and that's gonna be absolutely wonderful. Very nice, I like it. I actually did the same thing over here for the copper. This time around, I want to use up the copper ore first here, so I build it a little bit out of place. But once the 8 million copper here are used up, we should be able to make a normal module out of it, and then we're just gonna go ahead and expand all over the place. Now this is gonna take a lot of hours of playtime, so I decided to divide the series up into multiple parts. Right now we are basically doing the same thing over and over again, and I might be able to get some of the products out of the way. We also need way more solar power. I'm guessing that's another thing we'll have to take care of. Considering we're lacking the power at the moment, solar panel modules are gonna be the most important ones. So my suggestion would be to start setting up the rail network first, because we know how that's gonna go. It's always gonna be the same. It is definitely confusing, but if we build an exoskeleton of rails, then we have a much better guideline as to where we can place the modules, where we have space for solar power, etc., etc. But you can see, at the moment everything is working much slower because we are lacking a lot of power. We need 1.1 gigawatts. Alright guys, we are back. It is now a couple of hours later. Let me just show you what we've accomplished. What you can see here is approximately the size of the factory we had in the previous episode. Now, things have changed a little bit. If I zoom out, you can see a lot has happened, and as promised, I did set up the exoskeleton for the train layout that I want to have. And I also made sure that we have radars spaced out evenly so that I can have a look everywhere I want from the map view and can see what's going on. For instance, one thing I changed dramatically is the design of the loading and unloading station. I'm now basically forcing the trains to use the center line, except they want to go ahead and use the station. So the T-intersection is still the same. They have the opportunity to go on either line. However, they should prefer the inner line because the inner line goes straight if they don't use the station. And if they take the outer line, they will actually take a little detour here. So now from either side, they can only access the station if they are on the outside lane, and they will decide that inside the intersection. If they are here, they can choose the station. So theoretically, they should only prefer the outside lane if they need to use this station, or alternatively, they can also go up to this station, and there is one train space in between if I have multiple trains. But yeah, that's the situation so far. You can see my robots all over the place. Of course, it is utterly inefficient to build stuff like that, but you know, this is all happening in the background. I don't really mind, except for the power we're lacking. But this is the reason why I'm setting up all of these solar panel arrays everywhere. And now between each of these intersections, I have the possibility to set up a crafting module if I want to. So we can set up a loading and unloading station here, crafting module, unloading station or loading station again, and we're all good and settled, I would say. Now maybe to put this to the test, we should set up another module. For instance, we have some space right here that we could utilize in order to craft gears. Why the heck not? Let's bring our Spidertron over here and get this started. First things first, I want to get rid of trees and everything that's in the way here. We're then going to set up the city block like so. Next up, I want to build the underground concrete and everything. We're also going to need the same thing right here, which is just below the module. And then we need to set up this loading and unloading station. Did I make a blueprint? Yeah, I think I totally forgot to blueprint this. Let's go ahead and copy this over, but I don't want, let me see. Yeah, we definitely don't want the trains or the train fuel. I believe like that, this is gonna be good. Gonna call this loading and unloading, create that blueprint, and we're gonna store that in our book here. Yeah, probably there. We're gonna go ahead, add a loading unloading station here. This is just perfect. And then we can go ahead and design a module. So essentially what we want here, this is gonna be the station, let me see, unload iron plate. And maybe at this point it might be wise to also set up some logic, because we're gonna need to deliver iron plates all over the place. And of course we should always deliver it to the places we need them the most. But for today's episode, that's not gonna be a concern. I mainly wanted to plan out the base and get things set up properly. Well then, let's get into the design part. We want to craft gears, for instance. That's going to be a basic material we need to ship around. We want to fill this up with productivity modules, and we also want to surround this with tons of speed beacons. Now, can we do this similarly to the furnaces, I wonder? Might have to fiddle around with this a little bit. Let's bring some speed beacons in here. Wonderful. I just want to know how much this is already producing here. Okay, from the looks of it, we need more than one full belt of iron plates in order to get a full belt of iron gear wheels, which makes sense because the iron gear wheels are more compressed. But I was hoping with the productivity modules, I can kind of change that. However, only 3 factories are gonna do the trick. That's kind of insane. If we only have one full belt of input of iron plates, then we can get 0.7 belts of gears out of the system. So if I multiply this a couple of times, 4 times 2.8, what is the even number? With 10 belts input, I would be getting 7 belts of output. But that is just insane. I think we're just gonna stick to 4 belts of input. Yeah, check this out. Even with 3 machines, we're getting more than 1 belt worth of output, but we're using more than 1 belt worth of input as well. In this case, we can start taking a few things apart. Take away some beacons and then measure it again, and we can go down until we have 45 items of input. So taking out the productivity modules, for instance. Actually, I should keep the productivity modules in so we use less iron plates. Wait a second, what if we also used productivity modules inside of the beacons? Could I do that? Ah, no, actually they cannot be used in beacons. Okay, no problem. With a configuration like this, I'm using 46 items. If I take out even one speed module out of a beacon, then it already drops below the 45. Let's see, maybe if we only take out an item here, what happens then? 43.5, yeah. Oh, actually, if we go with a 12 beacon setup, it might be possible with just 2 assemblers. So instead of 8 beacons, we're gonna have 12 beacons. And look at that, just 1.5 assemblers. We could even use 11 or 10 beacons. So what we are gonna do is something like that. I'm just gonna go with the 12 beacon setup and remove the modules not needed. I mean, we have way more space for this contraption than we actually need. We can place this right here, and this should be affected by all 12 beacons. We're gonna craft some gears with productivity modules, and then all the beacons will have speed modules. Gonna need some power poles. Okay, I guess we can copy it over once, like so, and then we remove a couple of beacons. Oh, this could be perfect. Take away another module here. And now what do we get? 46.5. Not quite. So re-add the modules here, and then take out modules that affect both crafting stations. Yeah, also here, it doesn't quite add up. I'm either just below or just above the 45. So I'm guessing right now it's 45.25. So almost perfect. I can fill the rest of the slots with efficiency modules just to help out with the power a tiny bit. And now this tiny thing is going to be one of four modules. So we want to copy this over and place it in the dead center of this place. Have our input of iron ore and then set up the train. Yeah, I think in between the episodes I'm gonna fiddle around with the train system a little bit more. I'm not exactly satisfied, especially here. There are some minor issues I would like to take care of. But to wrap up this episode, I would say we get this contraption to work. If we check out the production rate here, we have a usage of 4.1 belts of iron plates and we get almost 3 belts of iron gear wheels. I realized I want to put a balancer on either side of a production, so it isn't even necessary to balance them as we take them out of the train station, because it happens automatically after that. Which is another reason why I would like to redesign that. So I'm gonna think about that in between the episodes, and then we can kind of get started from this point. I would say we've done a pretty good preparation in terms of planning out what we want to do with this. Now, I would say we just need more robots, probably, because they are rather slow at the moment. I would like to have about 2,000, maybe. We also have to think about how we can fill up other things with solar panels, such as the intersections. But yeah, without any further ado, let's get this started. We want to unload iron plates and we want to load the iron plates over here. We will be dealing with simple circuits in order to open or close certain stations depending on how many items we have in there. So eventually we can have multiple unload iron plate stations and only the one with the fewest items is going to be open. But since this is our first unload iron plate station, we are just going to go with it. We want to set up a locomotive right there. It is being fueled automatically. We set up 4 cargo wagons and then we tell it to do something. Add a station, load iron plates. We want to do that until full cargo and then unload iron plates. We want to do that until empty cargo and I guess we can already get started. Let's follow this train, see what it does. That's curious. It is taking a little bit of a detour. I want to know why. It could have gone into this direction, in my opinion, and then go straight. Ah, of course. So there is one issue. They cannot change to the other rail if they go straight. So if I have my loading and unloading stations really close to each other, the trains are gonna struggle. So that's another good thing to know, but I mean, it still arrived. There it is coming now. Okay. And it is... Oh no, it actually unloaded the iron plates. But yeah, I can see how the route is kind of not working out. This is why I want to redesign it. But there we go. We are now crafting the gears. And then in the future, we can pick them up with another train station on the top there. Wonderful. I think that's a good idea. But before we take this to the next level, the train system really needs to function properly. So I might end up redesigning the entire concept and then we're gonna implement it in our current system. At the moment, it wouldn't be too bad to replace all of the rails. But at a certain point, I would not like to do that anymore. I'm now pretty happy that we have the basic layout of the base going on and it is indefinitely expandable. It doesn't really matter where we have each individual crafting module, but it is going to be important to have way more solar panel modules than crafting modules. If possible, I would like the solar panel modules to be on the outskirts a little bit. This way the robots will not have to travel all over the place. But yeah, I would say with that out of the way, let's wrap up the episode. Thank you so much for watching, guys. I really hope you enjoyed it. Have a great time and see you in the next episode. Bye-bye.